The ocean is deep, dark, cold, and full of mysteries. The bottom is so poorly understood that we know the surface of Mars better than the depths of our oceans. But what we do know is that down there, things get big. Some might even say giant. Shrimp like crustaceans, longer than your forearm. Isopods, the size of cats. Crabs, the size of cars. And squid, so massive, they could square off with a school bus. But why? What is the reason behind these species growing so much longer than their shallow water cousins? This is deep sea gigantism. Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. Why does living in the deep make everything so weirdly gigantic? Is it something in the water? Or is it something missing from the bottom of the ocean? Let's take a deep dive into what's really going on down there and why life in the deep tends to go big or go home. The ocean is weird all over, but the real mythological creature-like stuff starts happening at around 1,000 meters or 3,200 feet. That's like three Empire State Buildings stacked one on top of the other, but imagine they were all covered in water. This is the midnight zone. The sun doesn't shine here. It's an unforgiving place, and yet over three quarters of the ocean are over 1,000 meters deep. So there is more area of deep ocean than there is land on Earth. This place is dark, cold, and home to one of the ocean's most mysterious and oldest giants, the Greenland shark. These massive sharks get up to 6.5 meters, or about as long as an American pickup truck. They're the third largest sharks in the world, but the largest active predators, because the whale shark and basking shark are plankton eaters. As you can probably tell by their name, these massive fish live in the cold waters of the North Atlantic and Arctic oceans. Unlike their movie star great white cousins, these guys are not flashy. They move at less than 2 kilometers per hour, the slowest known swim speed and tail beat frequency of any large fish. But this isn't laziness. It's crucial to their survival. Even though they can sneak up on seals and have been found with polar bear remains in their stomach, food doesn't come easy or often. They can go without food for several weeks, potentially even months, depending on the size of their last meal. But moving slowly helps conserve energy in a place where calories are rare. To survive in a place with no sunlight and little food, you have to be very energetically efficient. One of the key factors is metabolic scaling, the idea that as animals get larger, they use energy more efficiently. So even though the Greenland shark is massive, it needs surprisingly little energy to live. But on the flip side, it also has very little to use. So they're extremely slow and grow less than a centimeter a year, sometimes over centuries. Radiocarbon dating has shown the existence of 400-year-old Greenland sharks, making them the longest living vertebrates in the world. There are Greenland sharks that are alive today that were already swimming around England when Shakespeare was still alive. Their slow growth also means it takes a long time to become sexually mature. In the Greenland shark's case, it's around 150 years of age. A Greenland shark could have been born the same day as Winston Churchill, and is only becoming sexually mature today. But that kind of slow, steady growth over a very long lifespan isn't unique to the Greenland shark. And maybe even weirder, it doesn't stop. Myself and you, unless you're a deep sea giant, of course, grow to a certain height and then stop growing. But a lot of deep sea species don't have that hard limit. As long as they're getting food and not getting eaten, they'll just keep growing. And when you combine that with the fact that these animals often live for a very long time, you get some really strange, humongous beasts with long lives and even longer legs. Really, really long legs. The Japanese spider crab holds the title for largest arthropod on Earth, with a leg span that can stretch up to 4 meters across or about as big as a sedan. And yet, its body is surprisingly modest, not much bigger than a football. These towering crabs haunt the deep waters off the coast of Japan. And despite their terrifying size, they're not predators. Instead, they prefer the chill lifestyle of a scavenger, eating whatever happens to fall to the bottom of the ocean. Aw, slender crab's kinda nice. Predation requires a lot of energy, and few animals in the deep sea can afford to pay that price. This has caused low predation pressure, which has led to gigantism. When nothing's chasing you and you've got centuries to kill, there's room to grow big, slow, and strange. The spider crab isn't the only deep sea creature taking advantage of all that space and safety. Meet another bottom dweller built for the long haul, the giant isopod. It's a relative of the common roly-poly pill bug, but these armored crustaceans can grow to the size of a French bulldog. They live from around 200 to 2,000 meters below the surface, where they vacuum clean the bottom of the ocean. Almost anything is edible to them. Whale fall, fish carcasses, even scraps from shipwrecks. It's all delicious to them. Like other deep-sea giants, their bulk likely evolved in response to cold temperatures, limited food, and a low predator environment. The kind of setting where getting big and staying still actually pays off. They're so good at conserving energy, one captive isopod famously went over 5 years without eating, the longest recorded fast by any animal in captivity. It's the deep sea version of bulking season. Store energy, move slowly, and wait out the next meal, even if it takes months or years to arrive. So far, we've looked at animals that got big by taking it slow, conserving energy, playing the long game, and having no predators. But not every deep sea giant is built for a quiet life in the dark. Some got massive in part because of an evolutionary arms race with a predator. Enter the giant squid, with tentacles as long as a school bus and eyes the size of dinner plates. The giant squid is a real contender as one of the most terrifying ocean creatures of all time. Most common squid species max out at just a few dozen centimeters, barely the length of your forearm, making this giant squid one of the most extreme examples of deep-sea gigantism ever recorded. Its massive size is likely the result of its battles with the largest toothed predator on Earth, the sperm whale. What, did you think I was going to say T-Rex? Gotcha. While no one's ever filmed a full-on squid whale showdown, the evidence is etched on the whales themselves, in the form of sucker scars on their heads and squid beaks in the whale stomachs. Over time, natural selection likely favored squid that were large enough to escape, strong enough to fight back, or at the very least, harder to swallow. This is an example of size evolving in response to predation pressure, when the pressure to avoid being eaten leads to an increase in body size. Combine that with the other forces we've seen, cold temperatures, slow metabolisms, low light environments, and you have a creature that's grown massive by design. The deep sea conditions simply demanded it. There is another often overlooked factor that creates giants: oxygen availability. In some parts of the deep sea, oxygen levels drop dramatically. Oxygen minimum zones, usually found between 200 and 1,000 meters deep, are regions of the ocean with so little oxygen that most marine life cannot survive there. These midwater zones can have even less oxygen than deeper parts of the ocean. But the real fun stuff starts to happen after 1,000 meters deep. This is an area with little life, little death, and little decay. Fewer rotten things means more oxygen, and deep ocean currents bring additional oxygen to the depths of the sea. Animals that can live here naturally get bigger than animals that have lower oxygen available. Such is the case of the supergiant amphipod. Let's back it up a bit. If you've never heard of amphipods, all you need to know is that they're crustaceans that look like flat shrimp.
Most amphipods are the size of your fingernail, but the supergiant amphi can grow up to 35 centimeters long, about the size of a house cat. These ghostly crustaceans can live at depths of over 6,000 meters. Their gill structure helps them extract oxygen more efficiently than their shallow water cousins. That extra oxygen intake powers a bigger body. A body that's perfectly suited for drifting through the pressure-packed dark, scavenging whatever it can. It's a reminder that in the deep, even the tiniest creatures can take a giant leap if evolution hands them the right tools.
These are just some of the most well-known deep-sea giants. There are several other giants that we're just beginning to understand.
Dumbo octopus are beautiful, hilarious, and look like cartoony octopus ghosts. But they're also larger than the average human being. Their adorable ear-like fins help them hover around while spending almost no energy. Giant polychaete worms, like the bobbit worm, can get to nearly 3 meters long and get energy from symbiotic bacteria. And siphonophores, though technically not an individual animal but colonies of animals, can be up to 40 meters long. These ones for sure deserve their own episode, so we'll talk about them at length another time.
At the bottom of the ocean, life slows down and stretches out. And somehow, against crushing pressure, freezing temperatures, and total darkness, life, finds a way.
Understanding these animals can help us understand life as a whole. For example, studying giant amphipods has led to the discovery of unique molecules that protect cells under extreme pressure and stress. And these molecules may one day help prevent the protein clumps seen in diseases like Alzheimer's.
And the best part is that we've barely scratched the surface. More than 80% of the deep ocean remains unexplored, which means there might be other huge alien-like creatures down there just waiting to be discovered. And Godzilla. And if you want to learn more about the life aquatic, check out our episode about giant oarfish, an amazing example of how weird animals get in the depths of the sea. So what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching, and see ya!